say welcome to Two Rock Presbyterian Church, but I think you have been welcoming me. I am Joanne Whitt, and as you know from your bulletin, Brooke Scott is on vacation, and I'll be with you today, and I'll also be with you on the 31st when she'll be gone as well, so I'll have a chance to get to know you. I have confessed to a couple of people, the thing I'm most nervous about this morning is getting from here to Tomales on time, so I'm sorry I won't be hanging out with you at coffee hour to get to know you better, but don't forget that coffee hour will happen even without me. Kathy was going to highlight an announcement.
Little update on our collection for the folks that are moving into tiny homes. Those are over at the Mary Isaac Center. People were very gracious, I think it was last weekend, and I just want to give the people an update that gave me cash. I got 10 waste baskets, 18 pairs of flip-flops, and if you're looking for those things, definitely the $1.25 store is the place to go. And then I got 4 sets of sheets at Target, and those are rent $9.50 a piece. So get the microfiber ones, and those are pretty affordable. So anyways, that's my update. Thank you. And we're going to be doing that through July. Well, this is July, this month.
Thanks, Kenny. Are there any other announcements? We will be celebrating the Lord's Supper this morning, and it's my understanding that the practice here is to hold the elements until we all take them together. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Thank you. Please join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. Jesus said that whoever welcomes one of his followers welcomes Jesus himself.
Welcome to our worship.
Whoever welcomes Jesus also welcomes God.
Whoever offers even a cup of cold water to one of God's children will be blessed by God.
All are welcome here. Let us worship God. The hymn is 331. Stand if you are able.
love of God is beyond measure, and you are included in that love. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ. We are forgiven.
Scripture reading this morning is found on page 844 of your pew Bible, if you would like to follow along. It's Luke 10, 1 through 7. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Go on your way. I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, say, 'Peace to this house.' And if a person of peace is there, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house."
Thank you.
you've seen pretzels in a bunch of different shapes, right? Straight ones, but mostly we think of the ones that are shaped kind of like that. You know, sort of, that's a traditional pretzel shape. That shape was actually invented by a German priest a long time ago, and he invented that shape to remind people to pray. Isn't that kind of funny? Because a long, long time ago, people used to do this when they prayed, so that's kind of a pretzel shape, right? Anyway, pretzels became a symbol for prayer. And one of my very favorite prayers is called the pretzel prayer. And it's called the pretzel prayer because it has three lines, just like a pretzel has three holes. And it's very easy, and it's a good all-the-time prayer. And I'm going to teach it to you today, and then we're going to say it again when I'm back here at the end of the month, okay? This is how it goes. I'm going to say it once, and then I'm going to have you say it with me, okay? It goes, God, I love you. Help me to love others as you love me. Pretty basic, but pretty important, okay? Now let's say it. God, I love you. God, I love you. Help me to love others.
Help me to love others.
As you love me.
As you love me.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, we'll say it next time I'm here. Thank you. See you guys later. Our second scripture reading continues with Luke 10, verses 8 through 11. It's at page 844 in your pew Bibles. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. The word of our God.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
When you think of missionaries, you might picture young Mormons in black slacks and white shirts walking through neighborhoods and knocking on your doors at inconvenient times. You might picture Junipero Serra, whose chain of missions more or less enslaved the native population of California. What you probably don't picture when you think of missionaries is yourself. In this morning's passage in Luke, Jesus sends out 70 disciples, instructing them not only to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God, but to make it real by performing the same works of healing that he's been doing. He sends his disciples to be missionaries. We are Christ's disciples. So this is a mission we now share. Now before you start squirming, notice what Jesus doesn't say. He doesn't say, I'm sending you out to convert people. He doesn't say, I'm sending you out to save souls. He doesn't even say, I'm sending you out to try to convince people to come to church. He sends the disciples to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is probably a term that's familiar to you, but it's worth reviewing because when you start talking about something kind of scary, like being a missionary, our old preconceptions start creeping into our thinking. The kingdom of God is the central metaphor that Jesus used to convey his message. It was not focused on how to escape this world and its problems after death, but instead focused on how God's will might be done here on earth in this life. As one author puts it, the kingdom of God is God's dreams coming true for this earth, God's justice and peace replacing earth's injustice and disharmony. So maybe you're sitting there thinking missionaries are scary because they try to force their religion and culture on other people. That is scary, especially for many of us Northern Californians who figured out that other faith traditions have helpful ways of talking about God. But what Jesus is really sending his disciples to do is perhaps even scarier. What Jesus is sending his disciples to do is to change the world. Jesus is sending his disciples to change the world. Jesus is sending us, you and me, to change the world. That's a pretty big mission, isn't it? Jesus' instructions to the 70 disciples help break this down for them and for the rest of us as well. First, Jesus sends them to the local villages. It's like that old saying, think globally, act locally. Change the world, but start here. Eventually, Jesus sends his mission beyond the Jews and even to the ends of the earth. So it boils down to a question of what is our calling? Some disciples are sent to the Gulf Coast to rebuild houses after a hurricane or to other parts of the globe to build bridges. Some of us are sent to classrooms in Petaluma or offices in Santa Rosa, encounters with our next door neighbors or even with our family members. Next, Jesus says, pack light. Leave your baggage at home. Perhaps the baggage we most need to leave behind is our assumptions about who people are and what they need. The painful fictional example of what this baggage looks like is the Reverend Price in Barbara Kingsolver's novel, The Poisonwood Bible. Price is an American missionary who proclaims Jesus is Bangala to a group of confused villagers in Congo. He means to say something like, Jesus is supreme, but he fails to catch the nuances of their language, and what comes out is Jesus is poisonwood, the name for a local plant that causes severe itching. But language isn't the biggest problem. Price doesn't see the richness of the local traditions or the very real needs of the people. In the end, his mission fails miserably because he's so stuck in his save the pagans approach that he can't see the Congolese as God's children, created in God's image. He doesn't love them. He can't learn from them. In contrast, Leslie Newbegin was a real-life English missionary in India in the late 1930s. Unlike Price, Newbegin knew he needed to listen and to learn about the cultures of that vast country and its peoples. He lived among the people of India and came to understand that he'd been trapped in a Western perspective, which assumed that his way of looking at the gospel was the right way or even the only way to read it. India required him to hear and read the gospel all over again in ways he wouldn't have discovered had he stayed in the UK. If we enter the mission field around us, which, by the way, is everywhere in 2022, what do we encounter that requires us to hear and read the gospel in new ways? Alan Roxburgh writes that the two crucial questions that we're to ask as missionaries are, one, what is God up to in our neighborhoods and communities, and two, how do we join with what God is already doing in those places? These are questions which help us leave our baggage behind and require us to ask, how would we function as missionaries if we understand that the gospel is telling us that God is already at work in people and we're to participate with them? This may be why Jesus says, don't move from house to house. Settle into the neighborhood. How can you build relationships after all? How can you listen and overcome your assumptions if you don't settle in and take the time to get to know people? Jesus says, eat what's set before you. That means we enter the world of the other on his or her terms, not on our terms.
Churches often talk about extending hospitality, and that's hugely important. It's fascinating that what Jesus is talking about in this passage is accepting hospitality. The disciples will have to rely on the kindness of strangers. On a trip to Japan in 1983, my traveling companion and I stood in front of a map in the Tokyo subway trying to figure out which train to take to Tsukiji, the 56-acre fish market where restaurateurs and grocers buy the catch of the day. A man with much better English than our Japanese approached us and asked if he could help. It turned out that he owned a restaurant and was on his way to Tsukiji to buy seafood. Not only did he show us how to get there, but he showed us around, and we saw things we never would have seen without him. When we felt that we'd imposed on his hospitality long enough, we said that we needed to go, and he insisted that we come to his restaurant. We understood Japanese hospitality well enough to know that if we showed up at his restaurant, he'd insist on buying us dinner, and we thought this was just too much of an imposition. So we politely took his card with the address of his restaurant, we thanked him profusely for his help, and bowed our way out of his presence. We figured we were off the hook. Tokyo, with 12 million people or so, there was no chance we'd run into him again, right? Wrong. We were in a park near Ueno Station, and there he was. Why hadn't we come to his restaurant, he asked. He was so sincere and so kind that we put aside our Western definitions of imposing and went to his restaurant. He ushered us into a private room and sat on the floor with us at the table. And for the next 2.5 hours, we were treated to course after course of seafood like you can't imagine, and in some cases probably don't want to imagine. But it was a feast. He sat with us through the entire meal. His English was good because he had participated in the World's Fair in New York in 1964. But what he really wanted to talk about was World War II. Now, I wasn't alive during World War II, and he must have been a small child. But in 1983, the echo of that war still rang through the relationships between the American and Japanese people. I would never have known this if we hadn't accepted his hospitality. I would never have been able to see this part of his world from his perspective if I hadn't accepted his hospitality. Accepting his hospitality transformed me. This notion that we're to accept hospitality of others as part of proclaiming the kingdom of God really turns our traditional notion of what it means to be a missionary on its head. Accepting hospitality is vulnerable. It means we aren't in control. It means we're on somebody else's turf. We in the church are often convinced that we have to figure out how to get people to come onto our turf. But this passage this morning tells us that proclaiming the kingdom includes being open to what God is doing in someone else, on his or her turf. And that changes us. John Philip Newell describes a conversation he had with a Mohawk elder in Canada. "I have been wondering," the elder said, "where we would be as a Western world today if the mission that came to Europe centuries ago had come expecting to find light in us." What might it look like for us in our Northern California churches to expect light in our neighbors? I know your congregation has finished the mission study, phase one of a search for a new pastor, and I wonder whether your mission study team considered interviewing the folks in your neighborhood that don't show up to worship with you. Business owners, farmers, teachers, school administrators, town council members, you certainly know what that list would include better than I do. You might learn about their perceptions of you as a congregation, but also about the good work these folks and institutions are doing, the light that is already there, so that you can figure out how to partner with them in that good work, which is indeed God's work. as our nation celebrates its 246th birthday tomorrow. We can see all too well what happens when people remain in their silos, listening only to people with whom they agree, open only to ideas that only confirm what they already believe. We can see what happens when we don't accept the invitation to see, really see, what other people's lives look like. The church can take a different path. In fact, Jesus calls us to take a different path. When the conversation is mutual, when there is a possibility of learning and growth and healing on both sides, when we're vulnerable to seeing the world from a different perspective, then the kingdom of God is indeed near. May it be so for you and for me. Amen.
Sister Lynn, she's struggling with Parkinson's.
Yes.
Safe traveling for people.
Say it again.
Safe traveling for travel.
Safe travel.
I'm going into Sonoma Valley Hospital on Wednesday for a procedure on my back. And this is probably the last thing they can do other than surgery. And so I pray that the doctor's hands will be able to make sure that everything's well, and that hopefully, I pray that it will work this time.
This is the time that we remember that the ministries of the church depend on your generosity, both of your time and your talent and of your treasure. Let us worship God with our gifts. This table is not a table that we set. We don't choose the meal. We don't invite the guests. Friends, strangers, all are welcome. Christ is the host. We are Christ's guests, so come. Come to Christ's table and share in his presence. Please join me in the great prayer of thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
Blessed are you, our God, as the prophet Isaiah reminds us, you prepare for us a heavenly banquet, which is the feast of your victory over death, the joyful feast of your salvation. Therefore, we praise you, joining the song of the universal church and the heavenly choir.
Holy, 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 Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is Jesus Christ, our Savior. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Just as he called Lazarus from the tomb, we believe that he calls us to newness of life now and into eternity. Remembering your goodness and grace in Christ our Lord, we offer ourselves to you in gratitude as we share this joyful feast.
Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and cup, and make us one in the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. Show us your new heaven and your new earth, where death and mourning will be no more, and where we will feast with you in glory. Through the Lord Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Spirit, we bless you and praise you, God of glory, now and forever. We thank you, O God, for this community of faith. As Christ welcomed all to sit at table with him, help all who come through the doors of your church to feel welcomed. As we celebrate our nation's independence tomorrow, O God, we thank you for our precious liberty and for our nation's resources and prosperity. Do not let us take your gifts for granted or assume that we deserve them more than others. Forgive us, we pray, for our shortcomings as a nation.
Give wisdom to our leaders and steadfastness to our people. Make us who come from many nations with many different languages and cultures a united people. Save us from violence, discord, and dishonor, and also from pride and arrogance. We pray for safety and courage for those who serve and protect our country, at the same time that we pray there will come a day when your entire world is at peace. We pray for peace, O God, in Ukraine and everywhere people turn to violence to solve differences. We pray for your creation and ask that you would help us to care for it. We lift up the victims of the landslide in India and everywhere there is suffering. God of comfort and healing, many of us carry quiet prayers for the life and health of a loved one. We pray for healing of bodies, minds, and spirits, for ease from pain, comfort in grief, and peace in troubled hearts. We lift up Lynn, who is struggling with Parkinson's. We pray for safe travels, for traveling mercies for all those who will be traveling this holiday weekend. And we lift up our pianist, who's facing a back procedure. We pray that the doctor's hands will be skillful and that this will work. We pray all these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It was on the night of his arrest that our Lord Jesus sat at table with his disciples. He took the bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it, saying, This is my body, given for you. Take, eat, all of you, remembering me. And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink it, do so remembering me. For every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving life, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. The deacons will now serve the bread and the cup, and we'll eat them together after all are served.
Thank you.
This is the bread of life. This is the cup of the new covenant. Please join me in prayer. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the future to which you call us. Send us out by the power of your Holy Spirit to live and work so that others might know your love and that we might recognize you in others. Amen. Spirit be with us all today and evermore. Go in peace.